Again, who came to church tonight? They know what's up, because I need water. I usually did pretty well pushing through, but I find myself a little bit more dehydrated. They also did pretty well this morning. This morning, I dropped a couple LBs preaching. LBs means pounds. You guys came through Super Bowl Sunday. Give yourselves a round of applause. I challenge this morning's service with this thought. If God was before you, because that song that we just sang for offering says, until the day that we see each other face to face, I'll cry an anthem singing, holy, holy. And yes, there will be a time where we go to heaven and we'll get to see God face to face. But I also choose to believe that in the presence of my God, I get to experience him face to face, right next to me every single day. So there's no separation between heaven and earth. When I'm in his presence, I see him. I see him. So I challenge them with this. If he was before you, how would you praise? If Christ Jesus, who died on the cross for you, was right in front of you, what would you say? Would you try to be prim and proper? Oh, welcome, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you again for dying on the cross. No. If that is, we're going to have to figure something out by the end of service. Because if the man that paid the price for my sins, my transgression, with his life, came before me, I'd be on my knees. And my thanks would be in cries. If he's in front of you and you truly believe that your God is anywhere and everywhere and with you, tonight and tomorrow and for the rest of time, how would you act? How would you praise? Don't get so caught up in the routine and the comfort of your seat that you'd be too afraid to come and hit this altar and be on your knees. Praise him, glorify him. We've been kicking off this year with a series called Better. We preached about being bold. We preached about killing your enemy. We preached about putting your time on assignment. And last week, Pastor preached the house down teaching on excellence. So I ask you this, did you walk in excellence this week? Did you walk boldly into the office before the work that was before you? Whatever it is, whether it's tending to patients, whether it's pushing a mop, whether it's working on cars, or you're a cashier, or you're a bag person, or you are a table runner, whatever it is, a server, I don't care. Did you do it in excellence? Did you do it boldly? Did you slay the enemy of boredom and complacency? Have you put your time on assignment? Have you challenged yourself to lay out your entire week before you so that you could be better prepared and you can see where there's a lot of time being wasted? Or are you still just saying, you know what, I'm too busy, I'm gonna wait for 2020. You're gonna wait 11 months to get better? Because I'll tell you this, if you're gonna wait 11 months to get better, 11 months from now you're gonna say you're gonna wait another 12 to get better. So where has better been? Because we've already finished up the month of January. There's only 11 more left. What are you going to do, church? What are you going to do to get better? When are you going to get better? When are you going to choose better for you, for your spouse, for your family, for your children, for your grandchildren, for your job place? When are you going to choose to get better? When we're done with the series? Don't wait. Don't waste time. I said it this morning. This has been such an impactful series. This has been such a motivating series. But it only is if you listen, you pay attention, and you practice it. If not, it's just words. It's just maybe feel-good moments or moments of conviction that immediately evaporate the moment you walk out this door. And then you go back into the mundane of Monday. And then you just try to get through Wednesday, and then you're just pushing for Friday, and then Saturday, You relax from nothing. Better is here now. I said this in December. New is here now. You have access to it. Don't wait another minute. Take it now. Decide it now. Plan for it now. Walk in it now. Stop waiting. And now it's time to transition. Transition. It's a process. You can throw the definition up there. That process or period of time of changing from one state to another. It's a shift from one condition to another. In music, it's a momentary modulation from one key to another. Transition is a process from a starting point, from a launching pad to a landing point. When you bounce a ball, it transitions once it hits the floor to coming up towards my hand again. And I can choose whether to hold it or bounce it again. Transition is only a moment in time. It's only momentary. Transition is a shift from one thing to another, one state of being to another, one condition or position to another. I said this morning, we were going to change our view of transition. We're gonna change what we think of when we think transition. Because a lot of the times, as I said, it's from the starting point to the ending point. That's the in-between. That's transition. We love to go ahead and start something, and we love it even more when we end something. But when you end something in spiritual transition, your landing point becomes an immediately launching pad. So don't dwell in your landing point when you are following Christ. Because once you've hit another dimension, you are initiated to launch into another one, into another one, into another one. It's the moment that you decide to stand still or you get bored with transition, you become complacent and content with where you're at, and then things start falling apart because you're not progressing. Because you're not willing to push through the process. You're not willing to push through the transition. But we're changing that tonight. We're changing that. I'm going to teach you how to walk through your transition times. And I'm going to teach you that we all understand how to go through a transition, believe it or not. So, Father God, we come before you today. I love you. I thank you. I praise you. And I glorify you, Father God. I lay myself down before you today, Father God, that you would take control of my mind and my eyes and my ears, my voice, Lord, and my heart, Father God, that you would speak every word that you want to speak through me, Father God, effectively and clearly so that your people can understand and retain it and keep it and write it down, Father God. I thank you for this opportunity to use your platform, your gospel, because I'm not worthy to do it on my own. So we love you, God, and we thank you for in advance for what you are doing and what you have done and will do, Father God. We love you and we praise you. And everybody said, amen. So transition, everybody knows what I mean when I say transition. Everybody can relate to times of transition. Even kids transition from grade to grade. If they're in daycare, from classroom to classroom as they get older. From elementary to middle school, then you begin to understand transition a little bit more because you don't have the same teacher every day. So now you transition in between periods. From middle school to high school is also a transition time because the culture in middle school is very different than the culture in high school. And then all of a sudden, once you've established yourself as a 12th grader, then you're in another moment of transition when you graduate, whether it's into college or the workforce or living independently on your own, figuring out how to get an apartment or living with roommates, things like that, how to walk in full control of your life in a manner of speaking. Then you graduate college or you're moving from job to job. Those are moments of transition. Figuring out how to get the job that best sustains your lifestyle, the bills that you need to pay, the car that you want to have. You transition from your 20s into your 30s, 30s into your 40s, then you're middle age and you're coming close to retirement. Maybe you're a grandparent. You've transitioned into a new stage of life. You've begun to wear a new hat. Now you get to be grandma and you get to live in that blessing where you love the kid, but you can always give the kid back. I love being an uncle. Now I'm gonna be a dad and they say I can't give it back. But we're in transition all the time. You're in transition from job to job or in a promotion or in a demotion, whatever it is. You're in transition in your life. Everybody can relate to a transition. Say transition. Transition. Say transition. Transition. We can all relate. David's whole life was a transition. He was anointed around the age of 15 and became king at the age of 30. 15 years or so from promise and anointing to becoming king. God has a promise over every single one of your lives, and you're in transition on waiting for them to happen, or working through life until they happen, or when they are given to you. Transition. We can really relate to David's life. 15 years to walk into a promise that was given to him as a teenager? That's a long time of transition. That is a long process. And so we're going to dig into his life a little bit more the way that we have been the last 4 weeks. And we're going to teach you about moments of transition. What sparked transition? What did he have to do to walk through transition? How did he have to process through his transition and finally becoming king? And what he did then. Because even when he became king, he was still in transition to do more and more and grow closer to God. So we kick it off with 1 Chronicles 10, verses 13 through 14. If you don't know where 1 Chronicles is and you don't know the books of the Bible, don't get intimidated. It's on the screen. You'll be all right, okay? Everybody was new to church one time. Don't judge nobody because they don't know the Bible. You didn't know it at one point either. So make sure we understand that, okay? And the end of something sparks transition. And it reads, Saul died because he was unfaithful to the Lord. He did not keep the word of the Lord, and he even consulted a medium for guidance and did not inquire of the Lord. So the Lord put him to death and turned the kingdom over to David, son of Jesse. In this time, Saul has died. And the way that his death went was like this. He was in war with the Philistines. They were ganging up on him. They were ready to come, and he chose that it was better to die from his own sword than to die from the sword of the enemy. So he asked his armor bearer to kill him. And his armor bearer is like, no way, I'm not doing that. And he did it himself. The Bible says that he fell on his sword. And here in the Chronicles, they explain why he really died. He died because he sinned. He died because he didn't listen to the word of God, but instead consulted the word of a medium. And there was a couple of words that stick out to me that I'm going to teach you guys tonight. First, the word keep is a Hebrew word called samar, S-A-M-A-R. And it means to protect or attend to. Word of the Lord translates into a word called debar, D-E-B-A-R. So it translates into he did not protect or tend to God's matter or cause. The word debar for word of the Lord translates into cause or his matters. So it's not just a physical scripture. It's not just pages in a book or words on a page, okay? There's a lot more that goes to it when we talk about the word of the Lord, when we talk about the word of God, when we talk about scripture. It's a cause. It's God's cause. It's God's matters. It's the matters of the one and true living king, okay? And he did not tend to it. He did not protect it. Where do you protect it? You protect it in your heart. You protect it in your heart, and he didn't do that. Instead, it says that he consulted a medium, not just a fortune teller, not just Miss Cleo, okay? He consulted a medium that talks to the dead, that works with the dead, that tries to communicate with the dead for a prophetic word that God had already actually given him. And he ignored God's word. He didn't protect God's word. He didn't walk in God's cause or in his matter, but instead looked for guidance. Guidance translates to lidrowos, which is L-I-D-R-O-W-O-S, if you're writing it down, which you should. Go back and study these words, okay? And that means to frequent or ask of or even worship. So when he consulted for guidance, when he consulted somebody that dealt with dead things, he gave it time. And worship is anything that you give time to. When you give time to your job, you worship it. When you give time to your family, you worship it. Your kids, you worship it. Your paycheck, you worship it. The amount of money you make, you worship it. The time you spent relaxing, you worship it because you give it time. It's on the forefront of your mind. Yes, God calls you to get time away and rest, but that's time with God. That's just not time by yourself. So understand the difference, okay? Don't try to go ahead and twist up my words later and not do anything for a week and be like, Pastor Danny, no, Pastor Danny did not say that, okay? I do not put my stamp of approval on that, okay? But again, he dealt with somebody that deals with dead things. He dealt with something that was dead rather than the one and true living God. What do you deal with? What do you worship? What do you frequent or ask of? Is it people? Is it relationships? Is it problems and drama? Is it complaining? Is it laziness, complacency? What is it? Is it people? Is it relationships? Is it your spouse? Is it your kids? Because my God says that you should not worship any other God and put any other God before me. He is a jealous God. You spend more time with somebody else than you do with God, he gets jealous. And that's not something that you want to be on the other side of. He wants to spend time with you. He wants you to draw after him and draw into him. So what do you worship? Your coworkers, your friends, your spouse and your marriage? What are you consulting that's dead? Boo-boo don't like you no more, so stop dwelling in that. Go ahead and move on. It's time to move on. You're dwelling in a relationship that's dead. Friendships that are dead. Circles of friends that are dead. And you can't bring them to life yet. You yourself are not brought to life yet. You're not consulting in the one and true God that can give life. What are you worshiping? Your paycheck? Yeah, it may pay the price on the tag, but it does not pay the price on the cross. Okay? Yeah, it may be something that you need to live, but it does not give you life. Yes, in this life it has value, but it does not give you value. It does not give you identity. It does not tell you who you are. It does not give you life. So why do you spend so much time frequenting your money? I'm not saying don't pay the bills. I'm just saying understand, rest assured that when you are walking in the grace and the provision and the glory of God, he's going to meet your every need. Your every need. So stop dwelling in things that are dead. You are dwelling in your kids' lives because you want them to change. You want them to see the same light that you see every single Sunday because you've been transformed, yet you're not paying attention to the person that transformed you. You're trying to go ahead and smack something over them that's saying, hey, you need to do this because I do this. Did people do that to you and turn you on to this? Because I'm pretty sure that don't work. So why would you do it to them? You want to change somebody's heart, your moms, your dads, your aunts, your uncles, your husband, your wife, or whatever, but yet you don't pay attention to the one who changes hearts. The only one that can melt a heart, the only one that can break a heart, mend a heart, put a heart back together, fulfill a mind. You're not paying attention to the one that can do it. Why are you trying to dwell in something that's dead when you have to focus on the one that gives life? There's a couple of things you can learn from Saul's death before we continue. One, the sin of sinners will always make them found out. He did that in private, God still knew. That means whatever you try to hide keeps popping up like whack-a-mole, and you can't cover them all every single time they pop up. Somebody's gonna find out, and somebody's gonna ask questions, and then the heat really gets turned on, and you don't know what to do, so you run away. Nope, God's gonna find you exactly where you are, and he's gonna make sure that you answer for your sin. Secondly, no man's greatness can exempt them from God's judgment. This man was king. King over God's people nonetheless, and yet still he was judged by God. I don't care what your title is, your position is. I don't care what title you held before you came into this church. It don't matter. You lose all title when you come in here because on here you are just child of God and we all worship from the same level. So don't think you are too great to move out the way of God's judgment. Nope, you can't evade it. And then the last thing is disobedience is a killing thing. He was disobedient, and so that's why the Bible says that is why he died. He was disobedient. See, disobedience is a killing thing. It will kill your pursuit of God. It will kill your passion to praise, and it will kill your awe of God. It will even, at that point, kill your conviction, the conviction of the Holy Spirit that tells you what's right and wrong, that stirs up in your heart that when you make a mistake, that it was a mistake. You want to call it conscience? I call it the Holy Spirit. He's the convictor. And once you lose that conviction, everything else dies. It's a killing sin, disobedience is. It's going to kill your dreams. It's going to kill your desires. It's going to kill your future. It's going to kill relationships. It's going to kill friendships. It's going to kill your money. It's going to kill your finances. It's going to kill your peace. It's going to kill your joy. Why? Because you were disobedient. You didn't protect the word of God. You became disobedient, and now things are going to die. Oh, don't get me wrong. You're going to experience what the world calls success. But my Bible says that God has called you to live life in its fullest to the overflow. While these people, good people, right, just not Christian, not following God's will, they may be living full lives, but I want it to the fullest into overflow. So if they are showing me what a full life is, I can't even imagine what overflow is. So, oh, don't worry. You'll experience success, but you're not going to experience peace. You're not going to experience joy. You're not going to experience being content with God and walking in his provision. You're not going to experience that. Any relation comes through, going to die. Any relationship comes through, going to die. Any friendship, going to die. Any part of business plan is going to die. You may get what you've always wanted, and it's not even going to be all that. Disobedience is a killing thing. See, Saul's faithfulness was twofold. One, he didn't listen to God's word. And beyond that, he went and sought out a medium, somebody else. Twofold. When I don't listen to God, I listen to somebody else because I'm going to listen to somebody else. Saul's death, though, made a way for David to come to the throne. So something has got to die in order for transition to start. Something has to end in order for transition to start. Something has to end in order for you to begin the process. See, death starts or marks an end of something, but it also marks the beginning of something, okay? It marks the beginning of something. It might be the end of yourself that sparks a newfound relationship and trusting God in every area of your life. Once you come to the end of yourself, that's where God begins, and that's where transition begins. The end of something always sparks the transition, whatever it may be. Maybe the end of a job sparks a transition for you to find the job that God has called you to, or sparks a transition for you to start thinking about, why couldn't I keep that job? Maybe I have to go ahead and refine my skills. I have to work on getting better. And then that way, that is transition to a job that I can maintain and keep and be a part of and find joy in. See, again, it's the end that sparks a beginning. And transition, understand this, this is mind-blowing, doesn't come without opposition. It's always a surprise to us when we transition. Oh my gosh, we gave our whole life to Jesus Christ. I'm so excited. I see him in toast. I see him in bread. I see him in my cereal. I see him everywhere. And then all of a sudden, somebody's not as happy as me. And then I become angry and blame them for me being angry. Nope, transition just don't come without opposition. Why are you so surprised when you have a hater? You had a hater before you accepted Jesus into your life. You're going to have haters afterwards, okay? Here, it says, meanwhile, Abner, son of Ner, the commander of Saul's army, had taken Ishbosheth, the son of Saul, and brought him over to Mahanaim. He made him king over Gilead, Asherai, and Jezreel, and also over Ephraim, Benjamin, and all of Israel. Ishbosheth, son of Saul, was 40 years old when he became king over Israel and reigned 2 years. The tribe of Judah, however, remained loyal to David. The length of time David was king in Hebron was over Judah was 7 years and 6 months. Understand the word meanwhile. While you are in transition to putting your life back together and focusing on God, the devil's still at work. Meanwhile, while you are trying to better yourself, you're trying to recover, you're trying to establish yourself, the devil's still at work. Haters still gonna hate. Complainers still gonna complain. People still gonna backbite. They're still gonna gossip. Okay, again, transition doesn't come without opposition. Transition and transformation may happen like this when you decide to become a Christian and follow through with your faith walk, but it takes time to transition out of your reputation. And when you have people calling back your reputation, you don't like it. And so you go and retreat, or you become complacent or angry, and you stay in one spot. And then when you fall back, you blame God. Okay? Again, transition takes momentum to go from one place to another. But in that time, in that process, when people start getting at you, because there's always opposition in your life, and you choose to stop, when you stop, you're no longer in transition. And again, I said it this morning, when you stop, the world continues. So you actually don't get to start back up in the same spot. You're actually behind. So stopping in your transition puts you even further than behind, probably than where you were when you started in your transition. So be very mindful of that. When you choose to stop, sit down and pout in the middle of transition, understand this, there's always gonna be opposition. This man, Abner, was Saul's uncle. And sometimes in transition, when something's supposed to be given to you, it doesn't get given to you because whoever has it wants to keep it, okay? This was Abner's uncle giving Saul's son authority and kingship over Israel, okay? But Ishbosheth wasn't a king. He was a puppet king. He didn't have real command. He had the title, but he didn't have no power. The real power was in Abner because he was the brains of it and he had control over the army. This boy didn't know what to do. It don't matter if he was 40. He was still 40 with like 13-year-old problems, okay? He did not know what it meant to be king, okay? How many times do we hold the title of success, yet we don't have no power? That's why I said your title means nothing. You go ahead and you keep this constant pursuit of promotion, yet you have no power. You think your position gives you power. It doesn't. God does, okay? And even no matter where you are high up on the ladder, you still answer to somebody. Somebody else is still telling you what to do. You do not hold the power. Ishbosheth did not hold the power. Why? Because the promise belonged with David. We seek out that which does not give us any control, let alone life. We already explained that. See, David waited to receive what God had for him. Yes, he had the promise, but he did not go in, though he could. He did not go into Israel storming through, killing the king and saying, I'm king, it belongs to me, it's mine. Why do you do that then? Why do you try to go ahead and jump into your job, jump into your relationship and start claiming all these things that belong to you, that you should be have, that you have the rightful promise to, all this stuff? Nope. Why? Because kings wait patiently for the kingdom that they were promised so that it could be given to them. Let me go ahead. Some of you just stuck on the word kings. Kings and queens, men and women wait for their promise to be given to them rather than go and storm into the kingdom. Okay, David waited patiently. Yes, it was a test of his patience. Look at what the Bible says here. It said, again, that the people refused David. They took on Ishbosheth as king. They refused David. They rejected David. Most Israel rejected David, but yet God continued to use him. God continued to keep preparing him for the future, preparing him for usefulness. So when you decide to stop in your transition, you stop all potential of God using you. Again, they rejected him. Does that sound familiar? The Jews rejected and refused Christ. The Israelites refused David. The world will refuse you. Your friends now will refuse you. The workplace will refuse you too. But God, if you continue in your process, if you continue in transition, will prepare you for usefulness, will prepare you for ruling, will prepare you for your promise. Again, why do you try to go ahead and take what's yours? If it's already been promised you, it's going to come. See, you believe that because you're rejected, God has stopped working. But again, if you stop, God can't use you. And let me tell you this, God does not give partial authority over anything. I never heard God tell me I can have some of this and part of that and some of this. God does not give you things like it's a buffet line. He does not say you can take a piece of this and a piece of that and a piece of that. God gives full authority. So if you don't got full authority, you got no authority. Understand that right now, whether it's in work or in your family, you wonder why you don't have the authority and the respect that you believe you should have because God hasn't given you any of it because you're not worthy of it yet. Why would God have you rule a house and go ahead and just drive it right to the ground? Your job, your family, your friends, relationships, whatever it may be, God does not give partial authority. Let me go ahead and explain this a little bit further. David, anointed king. Ishbosheth was just made king. David, God promised an enduring and long-lasting kingdom. Ishbosheth, 2 years. David was like Christ in the spirit, and Ishbosheth was like sin in the flesh. Momentary, momentary. My God is long lasting, but Ishbosheth was momentary. Again, when you're in transition, the devil is still at work, so don't be surprised. Follow through with your transition. And the Bible continues on and says that the war between the house of Saul and the house of David lasted a long time, but David grew stronger and stronger while the house of Saul grew weaker and weaker. It says battle, but I want to explain it a little bit further to you. It actually is more like the Cold War, where it was just kind of a standstill. They didn't really do too much of anything. Maybe there were a few battles here and there, something small between a few camps or whatever, but not a huge battle. Because honestly, if David had followed through and it was a full-on battle, he would have won and his promise would have come sooner. But he didn't do that. He waited patiently. Why? Ishbosheth was just a puppet king. Had no power, had no authority, had no confidence. He wasn't gonna go after David. He probably knew in his heart, this is David's. I don't know, I'm not gonna try to go after him. But David just waited. And he grew stronger and stronger. You wanna know how he grew stronger and stronger? As time passed by, people from Saul's camp and Ishbosheth's cities would start moving over to David's side and start supporting him and started following him and started seeing him as king. If you just wait, the supporters you want will come to you. If you just wait, the encouragement that you want will come to you. The people in your life that are meant to be in your life will come to you. You just have to sit still, relax, kick your feet up, because God says he has the victory. So why do I even have to do anything besides look at the fight? You don't even have to swing. God says, I got the victory. I won it all for you anyways. So you just have to sit back, kick your feet up, face the fight, and I'll win it. Watch me win. Follow through with your transition. Yes, this was a test of patience for David. It's gonna be a test of patience for you. Sometimes you don't have to fight. You just have to sit back and watch God win. See, David had God's favor. It didn't stop the fight from happening. It didn't stop somebody else from becoming king. It didn't slow it down. It didn't speed it up. It didn't do anything. You have favor on your life, but you're confused why life isn't daisies and rainbows and unicorns. Why? This is still life. You're still on, what earth do you live on? Do you live on? There's still problems. You're still gonna feel frustrated at times. Don't live in your frustration. You're still gonna get annoyed at times. Don't live in your annoyance. You're still gonna get down and out. Don't stay there. You have favor over your life. That doesn't mean that you don't get hit with something once in a while. But transition leads to restoration if you follow through. Then Abner sent messengers on behalf of David to say, whose land is this? Make an agreement with me and I will bring all of Israel over to you. Okay, Abner is Saul's uncle. He gets mad at Ishbosheth and he says, you know what? Okay, watch what I can do. And he says, I'm gonna take all of this away from you. And he sends a messenger out to David and says, whose land is this? Understand that this has there's two reasons why he asked this. Two meanings. One, he's saying, who is this land promised to? Because he knew the promise that David had over his life. And he says, two, who actually really has the power? Who can really make this happen? Okay, why? Because sometimes you gotta work with the people who actually have the power. You might have the promise, somebody else got the power. You might have the promise and the dream, but somebody else got the land. Somebody else got the loan, okay? You might be promised your family, but you gotta work with the state. Okay, you might be promised your family, but you got to go through counseling. Okay, there's always going to be someone else that's going to say, make an agreement with me. But if you don't think like them, you don't believe like them, you don't see eye to eye with them, you say, agreement? No way. God's had a promise over my life. I'll be all right. And then you just sit in a dormant promise. You have to work with people. People are going to come to you with the power, with the land, with the loan, with the idea. They're going to know how to be, they're going to want to be business partners. Oh no, but I can go ahead and be CEO of my own company. Everybody has a dream to own their own company. Yeah, you're not equipped with everything. You got to work with people. You got to work with people. Why do you think you can do it all on your own? When you think about that, when you think like that, then you don't even rely on God, period. Because when you rely on God, God's going to say, okay, they're gonna make agreement with him. You're gonna make agreement with him. This is how you're gonna build your building. This is how you're gonna get a permit in the city. This is how you're gonna run this event. This is how you're gonna do this. But you don't even wanna work with people. He had to work with the opposing house to make an agreement. And then, get this, when you make an agreement, when you finally decide to humble yourself and make an agreement with the people you have to work with, it's gonna be on your terms. And it continues on, and David says, good, I will make an agreement with you, but I demand one thing of you. Don't come into my presence without my wife. Don't come into the presence without Michal, the daughter of Saul. See, David did not lose Michal, his wife. Saul took her from him. Okay? And he said, I'll make an agreement with you because this is going to be a way that I come into my promise, but I have, it's on my terms. So when you get to meet with these people, you're going to say, yeah, let's meet, but not without this. And if it's in God's favor, they're going to be like, oh, yeah, for sure. We're going to make that happen. We're going to draw that up right now. We're going to write that into the contract. We're going to do all this stuff. We're going to make it happen. You think right now, because you have to work all these off days and the times you can kind of hit church, work and don't work or whatever, that at some point you won't be able to make an agreement with your boss and say, I want weekdays, 9 to 5 to 8 to 4 or whatever, so that I can make time for God and I can come to church every single Wednesday, Tuesday. I can make sandwiches, whatever it is. You're going to be able to call meetings on your terms, but you have to come in agreement and make an agreement with somebody. He didn't lose her. She was taken from him. He had rightful possession to be in relationship with her, but he was taken. You have the right to your promise, but somebody else is holding on to the land, I said. They have the plan, you have the promise, okay? They know how to make it happen. They can get you your wife back. It was promised to you, and that's gonna be the thing that you would say, I want that back, okay? Again, when you make an agreement, you're gonna be restored to what was previously given to you. She was given to him. This was actually a way that Saul was trying to kill David. He said, I'll give you my daughter in marriage and make you my son-in-law if you go and kill 100 Philistines and give me their foreskins. Oh my gosh, first off, I have to go up to 100 different guys and try to fight them all, and then on top of that, I gotta kill them so I can get close enough to get that close and personal with them. Okay, but not only did he do that, he killed 100 and he killed 100 more, and he came back with 200. He killed 200. He paid the price for his promise. He earned what he got. You earned what you got. But yet it was taken from you. It was stolen from you. It was snatched from you. But let me explain this. This is something that caught my eye this week, and it was so profound. The cost for his daughter's hand in marriage was 100. He came through and paid 200. When you walk in God's provision and you walk in his plan and in his purpose that he has for you, he's gonna go ahead and credit your account so that you can pay double. Why? One, to receive it, and then when it gets snatched from you, so that you can pay to have paid in advance to get it back. Okay? You're not getting it. Okay. Again, when you walk with God, God makes sure that he has you covered for the initial promise, but then when it gets taken from you, you will have already paid in advance to get it back. The work that you do is work on deposit in your heart to get the promise back that God had for you. Someone else lost it, but you'll find it and you'll bring it back. You will reclaim what someone else lost. 2 Samuel says this, David mustered the pick of the troops, 30 divisions of them, together with the soldiers. David headed to Baalah to recover the chest of God, which was called by the name of God of angel armies, who was enthroned over the pair of angels on this chest. Okay, the chest of God, or the Ark of the Covenant, also what it's called. It was this chest that was built that God's presence dwelled on. Okay, David did not lose it. It wasn't even lost in David's time. It was lost in another battle. They took it from the tabernacle, and then the Philistines didn't want to keep it, so they eventually just threw it away, stored it somewhere else. And then David went back. David went back and got what somebody else lost. Plenty of people in this church need to understand this tonight. It's not your fault. It's not your fault. It's not your fault. It's not your fault. You didn't lose your identity. It was never given to you. You didn't lose your peace. Somebody disrupted it as a child, and you've never been able to get it. You didn't lose your innocence. Somebody took it. You lost a job. Somebody took it. You lost your family. Somebody took it. I don't care who you are. You've had something that was taken, and I'm telling you today that it's not your fault. Whoever made you think it was your fault, they're lying to you. It's not your fault, but it doesn't change that it didn't happen, and it doesn't change that because you didn't lose it, you should still go back and get it. It's your choice on whether or not you choose to dwell in the wrong that happened to you, or I'm going behind enemy lines and I'm going to go back to snatch what was given to me. It's mine. I worked for it. I'm keeping it. I'm taking it back. They lost it. You'll take it and your kids will keep it. The pastor that we come up under, he lost a lot because of his addiction. But he went back and he gained his sobriety. He's in his recovery. He gained momentum. He grabbed his promise. He grabbed his purpose. He holds on to it. And his children are going to keep it. And this church is going to continue to progress and continue to progress. Oh my gosh, if you don't understand what I'm saying. Don't get it twisted. We started at 4 so I could preach for 4 hours. You're so concerned about the game, go ahead and take a break now. Go right now. Go ahead. I'll go ahead. We can wait 15 seconds. Because I'm telling you, this word is not me. It's all God. You want the peace somebody took from you? Go back and take it and give it to your kids. You want the purpose? Go back and take it and give it to your kids. They lost it. But you choose to sit in it. You choose to sit in the pain and the hurt. I'm sorry it happened to you, but it's not your fault. But it is if you choose to not take another step in transition and go back and get it. And transition leads to transformation. They brought the Ark of the Covenant. They set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched. And David burned sacrifice offerings and fellowship offerings before the Lord. Transition leads to transformation. He became king and he did not stop at the throne. He went, this was his first act as king, to go back and get what was lost. Get this, to play. He flipped the script on religion. He put it in what the Bible says was a tent that he built. By law, Moses had built a tabernacle, a tent for the Ark of the Covenant to stay in, but it was lost. The presence was gone. For years, Israelites were worshiping to an empty room. Oh, you can sing loud, but if you don't have the presence, nobody's hearing it. God is not hearing it, okay? They worshiped to nothing. The presence was gone. And David brought it back. He didn't even put it in the same location. He didn't put it in a tent that had like gold trimmings and silver and bronze and nice curtains. No, he put it in a tent. Understand this, when you go back and you get the presence of God that somebody took from you, snatched from you, this is your tent. And I don't care. I don't care what you look like. I don't care what you talk. I don't care about none of that. You may not look the part. You don't have gold trimmings. You got curtains on for clothes. Makeup don't do it for you no more, okay? But you may not speak the right way. You may not speak the church type. You may not walk the church type. You don't look the church type. But the presence is in you. I said it this morning. I will take a down and outer with the presence over an up and comer that's empty. Okay, again, I will take somebody that's down and out but got the presence and wants to worship than somebody who's on the up and coming but got nothing. I don't care about their talents. If they don't have the heart of God, I don't want them on the stage. Don't worry about what other church people called you, how they judge. This isn't that. I don't care what your drapes look like. I don't care what your paint looks like. I don't care. As long as you got the presence, as long as you have the desire to chase after God and long for God and want to be one with God, that's what I care about. Don't worship something that's empty. Transform. A thorough and dramatic change in form or appearance or character of, induced or spontaneous. In 2019, you're going to transform. I'm going to speak that over every single life in this room today. You're going to transform, and it's going to be big, and it's going to be thorough, Maybe you've been transforming and it's been a half transformation. Maybe you gave half of your heart. You're going to give your whole heart. It's going to be thorough. It's going to be a thorough cleansing. It's going to be a thorough revival. It's going to be thorough in your life. He's going to take over every area of your life. That's the type of transformation I'm talking about. Thorough from head to toe, from your mind to your eyes, to your ears, to your voice, to your heart, to your legs, to your feet. Every step that you take in life is going to be a transforming step, a transforming step. It's going to be thorough. Either it's going to be induced, which means it's going to be provoked in this church, through the service, through the worship, through the word, through the hugs and the parking lot attendance and all that. It might be induced, or it's going to be spontaneous. The apostle Paul was first called Saul, and God knocked him off his donkey blind so that he could see. It might be spontaneous, it might be induced, but it's going to happen, and it's going to happen in 2019, and I'm not going to wait for December. I want it to happen tonight, okay? Again, we're going to skip, because this is the point right here. This is the point. Your transition brings you from glory to glory to glory to glory. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says that we will walk from glory to glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Glory to glory. Transition, transformation, and glory only know one direction. Only know one direction, okay? I explained it this way, okay? If you go from glory to glory and that's what's promised to you, even if you trip up, you trip forward. Okay, I've never seen anybody walk forward and trip backwards. It don't work that way, okay? But you can go ahead. You trip, I'm tripping forward, and I'm falling forward to glory, okay? When you serve a God whose glory you want to be in, it only knows one direction, glory to glory. And glory to glory is not steps, I said this morning. It's not one at a time. One at a time, one at a time. Oh, you can do that, but I'm telling you, when you go from glory to glory, it goes from platform to platform, dimension to dimension. You can start from the bottom, you can jump up. You can keep going, I did it this morning, and you can take two steps up, and you can be higher and higher and higher and higher and higher and higher. You go from glory to glory to glory. There's a difference. You're better for 2019 when it's glory to glory. If you want the glory, stand up. If you want the glory, stand up. It's completely different. We can move this. It's completely different. God saved you already. It's time for transition. The Bible says that He has moved me from the mud. He has moved me from the miry clay and placed me on solid ground. God transitioned you. When He died on the cross, when He sent His Son down for you, He already sparked transition and opportunity for salvation in your life. Glory to glory. No more backwards. It doesn't say glory 10 steps back. Glory 10 steps back. No. Glory to glory. You might have made a mistake, but you're not a mistake. You may have messed up, but you're not a mess up. Because when I messed up, it took me to glory. It took me to glory. If you are in Christ. If you want the glory, if you want the glory, I want you to come up to this altar. Redemption, but you've never experienced glory like this is today. You've never experienced the glory. And the Bible says with unveiled face. See, back in the time when Moses had to climb up the mountain to see God's glory, he had to go ahead and put a veil over his face because it would blind the people. Now we have complete access. David made that happen. That was the difference between the tabernacle of Moses and David's tent. I had complete access. I didn't have to go from room to room to room. There's no more process when it comes to God's glory. It's glory, then I experience glory. Then I experience glory, and I step into glory. Say glory with me. Glory. Say glory with me. It's glory. It's His presence. It's immediate, and you have access to it. So we're going to sing this out. I want glory. I want glory. We go from glory. We go from glory. I'll never be. I'll never be the same. I'll forever change.
Cause we go from glory. We go from glory to glory.
bow your heads and lift your hands with me if you can. God said to speak a promise over their life. That from this point forward, I'm moving forward. I'm not looking back anymore. I'm not drawing back anymore. I'm not looking at my past. I'm not letting my past dictate my future, dictate my promise. The promise is that I move from glory to glory from this point out. Over every life, you're moving from glory to glory. I don't care if it's in your problems, it's glory. I don't care if it's in your pain, it's glory. I don't care what it is. You can be up and coming or down and out, it is glory. We've gone back from behind enemy lines and we've brought the presence into our hearts. So from this point on, I've got access wherever I go. You have access wherever you go. And so now I walk from glory to glory. I run from glory to glory. I jump from glory to glory. I move from glory to glory. I shift. I pivot from glory to glory. I'm moving forward from glory to glory. I'm moving upward from glory to glory. I'm moving from glory to glory. Glory to glory. Say it with me. Glory to glory. Glory to glory. Glory to glory. Let's, as one voice before we close out in prayer, let's sing that you take us from glory to glory.
Glory. Lord, I thank you for Pastor Danny and for the message that you placed on his heart to deliver to us today, specifically for today. Lord, I pray that we are different people walking out these doors than when we walked in. Be honored in what you see in our hearts and in our minds. And we pray all of these things in the mighty, matchless name of Jesus. Amen.